Have you ever approached someone and said, "How's it going?" We've all done that, right? Now, 9 times out of 10, I can tell you what the response is. Busy. So busy. Crazy busy. Now, can you imagine if someone instead responded to our question, "How's it going?" with bored. So bored. Crazy bored. I mean, you and I would faint. I mean, we wouldn't know what to do with ourselves. And if we're honest, we would immediately think, "Well, I guess that person isn't very important or interesting. Or maybe he or she is just lazy." Why is that? Because in our culture, busyness is a badge of honor. Busyness is how we tend to find our satisfaction and significance in life. In fact, research even shows that many of us will lie about our busyness, because we know that that's how people will typically judge us. I will say this. When it comes to busyness, the women of Crossroads, they have a PhD in busyness. I mean, you ladies are outstanding. How you spin all of the plates, how you maximize your time, how you balance all the competing demands. As a single, as a married woman, as a mother, as a grandmother, as someone who has adopted children or even fostered children, as someone who has a career and yet finds ways to balance her life physically, mentally, emotionally, financially, and spiritually, someone who is a great neighbor, someone who is a church woman, someone who handles the finances, who helps maintain the yard, who does so much. Ladies, you are incredible. Can we show our appreciation to the women in our midst this morning? I would say you are busy. And many of you are busy with those things that truly matter. And yet sometimes in the midst of our busyness, we can lose sight of what's really important. We're going to look at an account today about two women. And these two women should be familiar to some of you who were here on Resurrection Sunday. On Easter Sunday, when I talked about these two women in John chapter 11, two sisters by the name of Martha and Mary, and their brother Lazarus. Today, we're going to be looking at another account about these two women in Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. And what we're going to find in Luke chapter 10, as we look at this story about Martha and Mary, is how we can ensure that we deal with distraction and busyness. How do we go about dealing with distraction and busyness, which impacts all of the women in our midst, but it also impacts the rest of us as well? Turn to Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. And if you're not familiar with where the Gospel of Luke is found, you can just turn 3/4 of the way into your Bible and you'll find the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Or you can use your electronic device and scroll down to the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. Listen to how our account begins in verse 38. "Now as they," the disciples, "were traveling along, he," Jesus, "entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home." So we immediately see Jesus and his disciples on a journey. They are headed to Jerusalem, but they make a pit stop at Bethany, which was 2 miles east of Jerusalem. They stop at Martha's home to be able to interact with Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. These were dear friends of Jesus. He could be himself with these friends. He wasn't going to be asked a whole lot of questions. He wasn't going to be deliberately tricked. These people deeply loved him. They cared for him. They refreshed him. They renewed him. But what we need to see is Jesus is on his way to the cross. He's on his way to die for the sins of humankind. So Jesus is on a journey and he stops to see Martha, Mary, and Lazarus in Bethany. Now, please keep in mind, this is before smartphones. Jesus didn't pull out his smartphone and say, OMW, on my way. I mean, he just showed up with 12 hungry preachers. Now, we know when preachers show up, they've got big appetites. So we've got Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, but then we have 13 preachers. I mean, this is going to be a feast, most likely, that Martha is going to have to provide. But stop and think about this. If we reconstruct this text, Luke says that it's Martha's home. So Martha is the host. So what would a host do in the ancient Near East? Well, obviously meet the guests at the door. She likely had Mary, most likely her younger sister, come and wash Jesus and the disciples' feet. And then she served drinks. And she ensured that they were comfortable in her home. But this is an overwhelming task, isn't it? And even though Martha is the hostess with the mostest, this is still going to be very, very taxing. That leads us right into verse 39. In verse 39, Luke writes these words. She had a sister called Mary, who was seated at the Lord's feet, listening to his word. Now, often we read our Bibles too fast, and it's hard for us to reflect upon the setting of the text. But in the Middle East, during the time that Jesus is ministering, in the home there was typically a couch about 2 feet high, and it could often double up into a bed. It's likely that Jesus is sitting on this couch. Perhaps his legs are even crossed as he teaches. And Mary, Martha's younger sister, comes into the room, and she doesn't step to the back. She doesn't go to the side wall. She goes directly to the center, front and center, and sits at the feet of Jesus. Now, you may be saying, well, what's the big deal about that? Well, in Jesus' day, Jewish rabbis didn't permit a woman to enter the room and sit at their feet. There were gender rules, and women took care of the domestic life, and men got to learn the Torah, the Old Testament law. But Mary decides to turn her culture on its ear, and Jesus allows her to do it. See, Jesus was countercultural. Jesus' goal was that women would be his disciples. Now, here's something very important to understand. Luke's gospel is the one gospel that emphasizes women more than any of the other gospels. The term woman is used 41 times in Luke's gospel. We start with Elizabeth and Mary in chapters 1 and 2, but then by the end of the gospel of Luke, we move to chapter 24, the conclusion of the book with women who are at Jesus' tomb. Now, I could spend a lot of time demonstrating the many episodes where women are spotlighted in Luke's gospel. But here's what I want you to hear. If we were to really unpack the significance of this story, it would be that Jesus desires women to be his disciples. He desires women to learn his word, to sit at his feet. This is why women's ministry is so important at CBC. We want to make sure that women are learning the word. And we have gifted female teachers who are well-trained and well-equipped who teach the word and help equip other teachers and then send women out to represent Jesus in the workplace, in the home, in the neighborhood, in school, everywhere women minister. So if you're a woman today who is not involved in women's ministry and would like to be, please sign up. Talk to one of our women's ministry leaders and let them know of your interest. We would love to plug you in so that you can be mentored by other godly women. See, Jesus wants us to know that women have a great deal to teach us. That we need to learn from women. And I'm speaking to us as men. We need to hear from single women. We need to hear from our wives. We need to hear from older women. We need to hear from younger women. I'm continually learning from my daughter and my wife. Wise men listen to women. And not just on Mother's Day, but every day. So here we have this account with Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus. And that's wonderful, isn't it? I mean, we love what Mary has done. But we need to immediately put ourselves in the sandals of Martha. Remember, she's preparing a banquet, a feast. And her sister has most likely left the kitchen in order to sit at the feet of Jesus. So she was once in the kitchen, but she left her sister to go listen to Jesus. But someone's got to cook. Everyone's listening to Jesus, but one person, Martha, is preparing this feast, this banquet. Martha most likely was cool, calm, and collected initially. But when her sister did not come back, I'm sure she began to pound her hand on the counter, if you will. I'm sure she began to clang some pots and pans. If there were any form of cupboards, I'm sure she slammed those cupboards. And then when she was slicing the carrots, chop, chop, chop. And then the huffing, the puffing, the frustration, the angst. And then that moment when someone said, Martha, do you need any help? And then in a stern, frustrated voice, I'm sure she said, oh no, I've got it. It's all under control. I mean, Martha is slaving away in the kitchen, missing out on Jesus' teaching. This is so sad. I mean, don't you feel the sadness? I have compassion for Martha. And I also have personal experience in this realm. Not in the kitchen, mind you. But I have been asked to do the dishes, take out the garbage, or clean the toilets. And I am a busy man. And I wonder whether I should be doing this or not. And my wife serves me like crazy. So maybe once a year she asks me to do something. And I have on occasion huffed and puffed and moaned and groaned and whined, even though I'm a wonderful servant. I mean, I have let people know that it's taxing. It can be exhausting doing some of these simple chores. May I suggest to you that you not do this on Mother's Day? I mean, you shouldn't do it any day, but especially today. If a significant woman in your life, or any woman for that matter, asks you to do something, do it with a cheerful heart. See, the reality is we can often find ourselves flustered, irritated, exacerbated when we are taking on particular tasks. But in verse 40, things really start to get interesting. But Martha was distracted. She was being literally pulled away in her thoughts. She is distracted with, notice, all, with all her preparations. Now watch this. Literally, the word is serving. She's distracted with all her serving. Well, that's interesting. And she came up to him, Jesus. She interrupted Jesus' sermon. Are you with me? And she said, Lord, one of the greatest lines in Scripture, do you not care? Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the serving alone? Then tell her to help me. She gives Jesus a command. Oh my gosh. Now again, can we just step back and say Martha has her hands full? I mean, she's somewhat in over her head at this moment. There aren't four burners available for her. There isn't a double oven or a large family oven. There's not a microwave. There is nothing like a refrigerator or a freezer. Martha is doing this old school. She is working her tail off, probably sweating in that kitchen in the ancient Near East humidity. And she has every right, perhaps, to expect that her younger sister would help her, but her younger sister is not helping her. And this must have caused Martha to see red. So she bursts into Jesus' sermon in her living room, and she says, Lord. So she honors Jesus as Lord. She knows that she's the host or the hostess, but he is the Lord host. In other words, she at least understands she needs to go and ask Jesus permission before going after her younger sister. But the way that she handled this showed that her attitude was not right before the Lord. The text obviously doesn't tell us, but do you think Martha went in and said, Lord, do you care at all about me? I mean, if she's going to interrupt, and if she is that audacious, she no doubt said, Lord, do you not even care that my sister is sitting at your feet when she should be in the kitchen helping me? I mean, this is not one woman's job. This takes some serious help. Then tell her, I command you, Jesus, you tell her right now that she needs to get herself back into the kitchen. And this is in front of a group of men and her younger sister. This was disrespectful. You don't interrupt the Son of God while he's preaching. I know she had home court advantage, but still, you just don't do this. It is not appropriate in any way, shape, or form. But she did it. Now, we need to ask ourselves something. Are we ever like Martha? I can tell you in my own life, there have been countless times where I have complained, I have whined, I have been at the absolute end of myself, listen carefully, because of my own busyness and because of my own distractions, but then I blame Jesus and I blame all of you. I'm teasing, sort of. Who got himself into that situation? Who overcommitted? Who had a hard time saying no? Who was always available? Who took on more than Jesus expected him to? Me, myself, and I. But I don't get mad at me. I get mad at the Lord, and I get mad at others. After all, I'm a servant. Just like Martha, we're serving away. And then in the midst of our service, in the midst of our busyness, in the midst of our overcommitment, we take it out on others. Can I just say, I often do things, and perhaps you do things, that Jesus never expected you to do. Or we do things that are right and good, but we do too much of it. And we don't involve others. Because to involve others would take more time. And we're so busy and we're so distracted, we're going to do it all ourselves. And then what ends up happening is we burn out. Physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Here's what's astonishing. There's nothing wrong with Martha's service. Martha has actually received a bad rap. What many of us don't realize is the context of this passage, the immediate context going back to the previous parable, the Good Samaritan, has the Good Samaritan serving and meeting physical, mental, emotional, and financial needs. And then what does Jesus say? Right before the story of Martha and Mary, verse 37 of chapter 2, and go and do likewise. Jesus is not opposed to service. He is not opposed to type A personalities. He is not saying, Mary and Martha. Mary is the hero. Martha is the villain. He's not saying that. He's simply saying that there is something about the preparation and the attitude by which Martha is carrying out her duties that is problematic. And we will see that right in verse 41. In verse 41, Luke writes, but the Lord, Jesus answered and said to her, to Martha, 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 you are worried and bothered about so many things. Now, I love this. Jesus doesn't show disapproval. He doesn't show disdain. I mean, he doesn't even show disappointment with Martha. He says tenderly and endearingly, Martha, Martha. When you use someone's name not once, but twice, it's a term of endearment typically. Jesus loves Martha. He cares about Martha. He's touched that she would want to serve him. In Luke chapter 22, Jesus demonstrates that he is the supreme servant. Jesus is all about servanthood. The problem was Martha was worried and bothered by so many things. Her heart was anxious. She became irritated in the midst of her service. Now, what if Martha instead decided to enter into the living room and spend just a few moments listening to Jesus' teaching? What if she spent just a few moments praying that she would have a godly heart amid her service? What if she then went back into the kitchen and said, Lord, I would much rather be sitting at the feet of Jesus with my sister. I want to be in there. I feel like I'm missing out, but I know as the oldest, my heart is to serve, and I want to minister to Jesus and his disciples. What if she said, I am so glad that Mary can sit at the feet of Jesus, and by me serving in the kitchen, I am allowing my sister to be spiritually fed by the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. It would have made all the difference in the world. Jesus wouldn't have said, Martha, Martha, you're worried and bothered about so many things. He would have said, Martha, thank you for serving so selflessly, so sacrificially, when I know you'd love to be in here with all of us. Thank you that you're providing for us, that you're using your spiritual gift of hospitality and most likely, additionally, service to build me, the disciples, and your family up. It would have made an amazing and astonishing difference. And it was possible. It really was. Which is why Jesus concludes in verse 42 with these words. But only one thing is necessary or needed, for Mary has chosen the good part, which shall not be taken away from her. There were many things that were necessary. The hostess needed to minister to the guests. She needed to prepare the meal. She needed to be sensitive to others. But Jesus says, Mary has chosen the good part. Some of our translations have the better part, but that's not the word in this context. It is the word good. Again, Jesus is not saying that Mary chose far better than Martha. Oh, Martha, if you would just sit at the feet of Jesus all day, you wouldn't have any problems in life. See, if everyone sat at the feet of Jesus all day and all night and never served, we wouldn't get anything done. There would be no church. There would be no outreach. There would be no global missions. There would be no raising a godly family and discipling the next generation. None of that would get done. And we tend to go to extremes. We either work our tails off or we choose to just find spiritual solitude and do as little as possible. And both are extremes. But yet both have their place. Jesus refers to a good part or a good portion. Now here's what's interesting. That term portion is actually used in the Old Testament of food. I think it's quite likely that Jesus is using a play on words here. And Luke catches it. And he says, Martha is all about physical food, but Mary is focused in on spiritual food. Remember John 6, the bread of life? Jesus is the bread of life. So many women and men understand what it's like to prepare a meal and to be in the kitchen for a few hours, and then your children and your spouse inhale the meal in 10 minutes. And you've barely sat down from all of your service and preparation. My wife tells me that's maddening. Physical, temporal food only lasts for a short while, but spiritual food lasts forever. Mary chose the good part. Martha could have chosen the good part by first going to Jesus, getting into his word, hearing his word, listening to his word, spending some time in prayer. Not that she would have sat at Jesus' feet for hours. She had service to perform. But she needed a spiritual gut check. She needed to get her heart right before the Savior. So if we were to sum up this story, we could do so in a very simple way. Let Christ serve you before you serve others. That means in all of our tasks on a daily basis, we pursue Jesus Christ. We listen to him as he reveals himself in his word. We come to him and sit at his feet, even if it's for 5 minutes, before we care for our kids or go off to work or go to church. We just spend a few minutes reflecting on perhaps one verse, because that's all that a lot of women have time for, particularly in the mornings or in the evenings. And we say, Lord, would you feed us a good portion from your word? And then would you help us to pray this scripture back to you so that we can be empowered and energized for our day? Because we know we can't do all the tasks that you have called us to, perhaps. We are busy. We are distracted. So what do? We go to the Lord first. Let Christ serve you before you serve others. Because if Christ serves you first, if he invests in you, if he speaks to you, if he touches you, if he reveals himself to you, you then have something to offer others. Let Christ serve you before you serve others. Now, this story is a beautiful story, but we're still left with, well, what about Martha and Mary? I mean, how does Jesus really feel? I mean, certainly he likes Mary more than Martha. In John chapter 11, the passage that we walked through on Easter Sunday, John chapter 11, verse 5 says something beautiful. As the narrative really begins, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister, Mary isn't even named, and Lazarus. And then the account that takes place has Lazarus passing away and Martha running to meet Jesus outside of town. And after some dialogue in John chapter 11, verses 25 and 26, Jesus says to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Martha expresses that she believes that Jesus is the Christ, the one who has come into the world. She places her confidence in Jesus Christ. You can make that same decision today. If you are persuaded that your busyness and your work and your accomplishments and all that you are is not sufficient, there's one person to turn to, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus lived a perfect life doing the Father's will for 33 years. The climax was he died on the cross for the sins of humankind. He demonstrated he was God by rising from the dead. He is seated at the Father's right hand, and he is inviting women, men, and children to place their faith in him and in him alone. By grace, through faith, in Christ alone. The greatest Mother's Day gift is that Jesus has offered himself to all of us. And we don't have to be busy in our work. We don't have to achieve. We can simply receive. We can receive the free gift that Jesus offers of himself. Let Christ serve you before you serve others. We're going to spend just a few moments in prayer, and we're going to ask that the Lord would allow us to do that. So please join me in prayer. This is an opportunity for you to do business with the Lord on this Mother's Day. Father, we come before you and we acknowledge that we are needy and that you provide for all our needs. You meet us where we're at. We are faithless, but you are faithful. We are weak, but you are strong. Lord, would you help us today to express our gratitude to you that you have sustained us through all of our responsibilities. Give the Lord praise for that in the privacy of your heart. Just take a few moments. Many of us are consumed with doing things for Christ, and yet there's a difference between doing and being. There's a difference between doing and knowing Christ. Would you just acknowledge this morning that, like me, you have failed in some of these regards? You have put your tasks before the Savior. Just acknowledge that. Confess your sin with me. Father, we don't want to leave this place unchanged. We pray in faith that you would help us to seek you first, to spend time at the feet of Jesus, to get into your word. Lord, that we wouldn't think we can do the things that you call us to without first letting you invest in us. Right now, would you commit to reading a portion of Scripture or spending time in prayer? Or being silent before the Lord your God. Choose a particular practice or discipline that you want to take on beginning today and ask the Lord's grace to commit to that. Father, we thank you for this time. Thank you that you love Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, but that you love us in spite of our foibles and failures. You love us. Thank you for your good work in each one of us. Thank you for your love for mothers, for men, and for children. And we pray today that we would be about the Lord Jesus' work. Show yourself strong in us, and we will give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.